Proverbs chapter 20. Wine is a mocker. Well, there are people that mock us with the gospel. And here the Bible is spoken as wine mocks itself. Habakkuk 2:12-14. Proverbs 23:29. Leviticus 10:9 about drinking. And this is not just wine, as in grape juice, new wine. This is stuff that has fermented. And when you get too involved in drinking this wine, you make yourself to be a fool by your actions, conduct, talk. Strong drink is raging. Get you in fist fights, get you angry and trouble. And whosoever, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him. So this is not written to a Jew. This is written to whosoever is deceived. Wine, strong drink, deceived. Now go back a few nights ago. When we talked about being deceived, if not the second John study, one of them studies, I talked about the second John being deceived. That is of Satan. That's not God. You know, it's a mocker that, oh, you know, we drink the wine that's Christ's blood. Literally, that's a mocker. Which they use a strong drink. And they are deceived to believe that is the literal body and blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, suck your blood. You know. Vampires. I think vampires wear black, don't they? Not only they're deceived, thereby is not wise. So if you're not wise, what's Proverbs tell you? You're a fool. The fear of a king as a roaring lion. We just read that the other night. It's a verily, verily. It is so important that it's written twice by Solomon. And, well, whoso provoketh him to anger sinneth against his own soul. Psalms 2:10-11 and Romans chapter 13, verses 1 by 4 or 5. So let me ask you a question. I know we don't have a king in America. We have a president. Romans 13 says, obey the powers that be, that person set in the thing. If you get the president angry by what you say about him, whether he knows you personally or not, or just the general talk that Christians are talking about him, and he gets angry, the Bible says you sin. Now don't tell me he doesn't get angry by what is said about him. Unless he's got more grace than anybody else. You know, David had power to put Nathan to death. It is an honor for a man to cease from strife. Get away from it. Walk away. But every fool will be meddling. Keeps going back, keeps toying with it like a mouse with a cat. Just walk away from it. Or you're a fool. You know, it's things in a marriage that if you just keep bringing it up, you got a foolish marriage if you keep bringing it up. You know, if you work that with verse 1 with wine and strong drink, the strife you get from drinking, you keep going back to it, keep getting involved in it, you're a fool. You're not wise. Now, I know I may be stretching the strife with wine and drinking, but that causes troubles and problems whether you're at the bar with the people you're going to fight with, or coming home and starting a fight with your wife, or the arguments with the family, or the boss. Drinking brings strife. You're a fool. The sluggard, the lazy guy, will not plow by reason of the cold. Oh, it's too cold. I'm not going to work. Excuses. All right, boss. Yeah, my toenail, my little toe hurts. I'm not going to come into work today. Then he wonders why his check is short. Laziness. Therefore, shall he beg in harvest and have nothing, or sign on to welfare and let the government take care of him? You would add to American Standard Version. I'm not talking about the American Standard Version as the Bible, but if you want to bring the Bible up to date to American standards, that would be it right there. The Bible says if you don't work, you don't get no harvest, and you get nothing out of it. You get no money from selling what you made. You get no food to fill your belly. You know, if you go out and plant corn, you're not going to eat all that corn. Even if you can it and jar it and preserve it, you're still going to have corn left over where you can sell it to your neighbors and get money. But if it's too cold to plant, what do you got? All you got is a bunch of dirt and weeds out there. And it says something about yourself, too. When it comes harvest time, I've seen pictures, and I would think maybe Kansas, but out in the Central of America, Central North America, I'm saying, you'll see all these corn fields, and it's just corn as far as the eye can see, except for maybe a little path. You know what you find with the sluggard? Here's all this corn, or maybe all this wheat. Then you come up to this little patch of ground, and there's nothing there. That's the sluggard. What's he going to get out of that? Absolutely nothing. Counsel in the heart of man is like deep water. So, well, put your bucket down in there. It's the proper counsel for man. Listen, I would not go to a guy who has declared bankrupt and ask him about financing. I would not go up to a guy who's been married 3 or 4 times and ask about marriage counseling. I wouldn't go up to a man in jail and ask him how to have a good character. You need counsel from a man. If it's about your car, you go to a dealer. You go to an auto mechanic. It's about finances, you go to an accountant. You got an electrical problem, you go to an electrician. You know, you don't go ask a single male or female about raising children. That's why the Bible says that a bishop is to be married and have children. Imagine a guy who gets up in the pulpit, he's going to counsel people about marriages, and he's never been married himself, or he's fresh out of the greenhouse. He's a plant that hasn't weathered storms and had too much rain and not have enough rain and too much sun and too much cloudy weather. You got to go for counsel to the proper person. I say that because Rehoboam, who this book is written to, does not. In the end, he goes to the aged men that Solomon knew, but then later on he goes to the youngsters. And hears to their advice and divides the nation, which has not got back yet. But a faithful man who can find. Well, that's interesting. Proverbs 25:14, Matthew 6:2, and Luke 18:11. A faithful man, who can find? Jesus Christ. Even I'm not faithful. I may say right now that the Luke study will be put to Friday night, Lord willing. Something may come up and say, well, we can't do it that night. I'm not faithful. I may buckle. Something may come up. But who is true to his word all the time? The Lord Jesus Christ. Most men will proclaim everyone his own goodness. See, a faithful man is a quite opposite of a man who thinks highly of himself. Someone who thinks they're it. Alright? The verse proclaims, are you 100% faithful? You really think you are it. But a faithful man, who can find? Somewhere you're going to fall. You're not that good. I'm sorry. You know, even Jesus Christ didn't proclaim his own goodness. He proclaimed the goodness of God. The just man walketh in his integrity, holiness, soundness. His children are blessed after him. I mean, if he's brought up integrity, he's going to bring up his children right. And they're going to be happy. A king that sitteth in the throne of judgment scattereth away all evil with his eyes. Revelation 20, verse 11. That is the Lord Jesus Christ. There would be no wickedness in the eyes of a king. He and Nehemiah was scared when he was just of sad countenance. Esther said, I haven't been called in this kingdom, man. If I step in this kingdom and he's not happy with me, off goes my neck. The king was mad at Haman, and they came in right away and covered his head. There was no questions asked. That's why America didn't want a king. They wanted somebody that they could vote for, and rules and regulations they could vote for. They did not want an absolute authority, as such as the Bible. That's what a king is. He doesn't adhere to Senate powers and stuff like that. He is the royal monarch. You know how royal he is? You don't go pick somebody when he dies. His son. Or somebody that comes in and conquers the nation. There's no ifs, ands, or buts when it comes to a king. It's absolute mercy or absolute death. Who can say, I have made my heart clean? No one. I am pure from my sin. Only by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Isaiah 64, 6. Acts 15, 9. Psalms 90, verse 8. 1 John 1, 9. That's the only way? That verse can't even apply to an Old Testament saint, because when they died, they went to Abraham's bosom. Until the Messiah came and died and was buried and arose from the grave. I can say my heart is clean, but guess what? I had nothing to do with it. I can't say I have made my heart clean. I really can't say I am pure from my sin because I'm sinning now. I'm washed in the blood, but, you know, if I get a thought, if I do something wrong, diverse weights, different size weights, usually wrong ones, diverse measures, you mean standard and metric? Would that be? God laid out for the Jews a ephah, a pound, a shekel. You weren't to bring in any other, you were not to bring in Egyptian or Babylonian measuring items. Both of them, diverse weights and diverse measures, are alike abomination to the Lord? Are you telling me as witchcraft, as sodomy, as a wicked man and his wicked thoughts are equal to diverse weights and diverse measures? You better believe it. Shortchanging your customers is an abomination to God. Now let me just ask you a question, my friend. Are you absolutely giving everybody a pure gallon of gasoline? A pure gallon of milk? A liter of soda? Are you giving your employee a full amount of wages to what he's doing? Employee, are you giving to your employer a full amount of labor for your wages? Deuteronomy 25:13 on that one. Verse 23 of this chapter. Proverbs 11:1. Proverbs, I think that's 16:10, or maybe try 10:11. My eyes are bad. Deuteronomy 25:13. Micah 6:10-11. God has much to say about weights and measurements, and we'd probably go all night. We're not going to. But that abomination that God has for the mean, wicked sins. You know, when you go to the grocery store and you're feasting on grapes, and then you put the grapes on the weighing to be weighed, and you ate half the grapes. You know, even a child is known by his doings. 1 Samuel 16:7. Whether his work be pure, run that back to verse 9, and whether it be right, Romans 7:7-10. So what about an adult that knows better? Just saying. The hearing ear. The seeing eye. See how simple the Bible is? That's simple. Ready? The Lord has made even both of them. Exodus 4:11. When God's speaking to Moses about, I'm not eloquent of speech. When God says, who made the man's mouth? How hard is that to teach that in the school system? That God made it. There's creation right there in the Bible. So now that we have an all-Republican or Republican control of the United States, all right, so their first official act, they want to get America right, is go in there and say, throw the evolution out and bring in creation. Because we're one nation under God. I wonder how many of those Republicans that were voting in quoted from the Bible, spoke of God and Jesus Christ to get the Christian foolish votes. And we'll leave evolution in the school where the Bible says the hearing ear, the seeing eye, the Lord has made even both of them. How more simple? Love not sleep. Isn't that simple? Least thou come to poverty. Now, all poverty is not because of you know, too much sleep. But sleep causes poverty. Open thy eyes, the hearing ear, the seeing eye, that God made, and thou shalt be satisfied with bread. Get up, open your eyes, go to work. Ephesians 1:18, and I apologize again, my eyes are messed up. I believe that's 5:14. It is not, said the buyer. You gave me a bad deal. What a terrible deal you gave me. Never coming back here again. But when he is gone, his way. And he goes, hey, check out this deal I got. That guy was a sucker over there. Look at all the money I made out of that. I would think that's a lie. God don't like boasting either. That's pride. You know, that car, it's 11. Oh, man, you know, we're going to have to get tires in a couple years. And dipstick, you know, is not totally painted. It's got some rust on it. You know, man, you know, phew. Hey, that's a nice car you get. Yeah, I got the guy knock off $1,000 off it. You mean you cheated him? Diverse weights and diverse measures, both of them are like an abomination to the Lord? Well, what's that have to do with weights and measures? When you're dealing with a guy, oh, it's a piece of junk. And when you go to your friends, hey, isn't it a great car? That's two measurements. That's, hey, to get a deal and look what a great deal I got. That's an abomination. Now, there's seriously wrong with that product you're buying. You mentioned it to the guy, but if you're just doing it to get a deal, God's not for that. I'm sorry. There is gold and multitude of rubies. Worldwide, I guess. Yeah, this was written when they didn't even know about California and the gold rush. I think the Mayan temples had gold and all that, even before the Jews even knew that they were over there. This is written about 1000 BC, according to Usher. That's 2,492 years before Christopher Columbus. But the lips of knowledge are a precious jewel. The knowledge of what? How about the Word of God? How about taking somebody who's saved and guide them to grow in Christ? How about taking someone who's not saved and giving them the knowledge about Jesus Christ? That's a precious jewel. You know what you get that precious jewel? You'll get it in a crown at the judgment seat of Christ. That's what that knowledge is. We had a woman the other day, you were yelling and you don't have love. Yes, I do. Because I am showing people what the knowledge of God is. You know what the knowledge is? There is a hell. There is a thing called sin. And for another person, prescription is a good illustration. I've used the knowledge to get the gospel out, to help Christians to grow. Take his garment that is surety for a stranger. collateral. As we've gone over before, you do not take surety for a stranger. If you're going to be that stupid, take his cloak. That may be, you know, that may be saying, I don't know. Take his cloak. He may not pay it. So take the collateral now. That guy is such an idiot to take a surety from a stranger. Chapter 6, verses 1 through 3, and chapter 22, verse 16, I believe it is. Again, I apologize for my eyes. And take a pledge. I pledge allegiance. No, it's not that kind of pledge. It is that kind of pledge, but not to the flag. It's, you know, it's endowment. It's a vow of him for a strange woman. I can't elaborate on that a little bit. You shouldn't even be with a strange woman, Solomon. You didn't practice what you preached, Solomon. A man that had three anniversaries for every day of the year. I mean, bread of deceit. Well, there's that deceit again. Is sweet to a man. All right, let's run that back to the wine and strong drink. Bread of the sea. What could you say that is? This is the body of Jesus Christ. Aren't you deceiving him? It's sweet to a man. It's sweet to those Roman Catholics. They just think it's just so wonderful. But it's deceit. But afterwards, his mouth shall be full of gravel. What a way to break your teeth. Their rock is not as our rock. How about that one? That's what gravel is. Our rock is Jesus Christ, right? Who is their rock? Every pope back to Peter, right? Do you know what gravel is? It's a whole bunch of rocks. Their rock is going to bust their mouth. You can't swallow when it comes to with rocks in your mouth. John chapter 3, verse 19, Romans 1, 32, chapter 23, verses 5 and 6, and chapter 10, verse 2. Every purpose is established by counsel. It better be. And with good advice. What's the Roman Catholic Bible say for that verse? Thou shalt not kill, you know. Make love, not war. With good advice. Luke 14:31, what did Jesus say? That king would sit down and figure out how many soldiers he's going to need? First Kings chapter 22. He that goeth about as a talebearer reveals secrets. Uh-oh, that's not good. I thought secrets are to be kept quiet. Therefore, meddle not with him that flattereth with his lips. Keep away from a talebearer and keep away with a flatterer. We've already discussed the flattery and talebearers. Okay? Whoso curses his father or his mother, check note here, Exodus, you gotta forgive me, please. 21:17, Leviticus 20, verse 9, Matthew 15:4, Jesus said, let him die to death. Whoso curses his father or his mother, his lamp, life. Light shall be put out in obscure darkness. Deuteronomy 21:20. Father and mother are authority figures. I mean, that's what the Bible says. You curse your mother, you curse your father. The Old Testament, you were to be put to death. Maybe we did that to America today, these children. Maybe there wouldn't be shootings in schools. Maybe a little 70-year-old punk girl won't go up to a street preacher and think she's got something to say. Imagine a young girl going to someone older and telling that person to shut up. Had I done that if I was her age, I wouldn't be able to sit down for a while. And everything, and practically everything, would be taken away from me. There is no discipline of children today in this country, and we are now reaping Dr. Spock. And it's only going to get worse if the Lord tarries, especially during the 7 years of tribulation, when you've got a generation who's not correcting their children, a generation of children who have not been corrected, going to raise children that they're not going to correct, and they're going to raise the children that have not been corrected to be corrected and would have no right or wrong. Could it be possible the Lord tarries and this country survives that you will have no courthouses? Because what would be right or wrong? Inheritance may be gotten hastily at the beginning. Anybody think of a story that somebody got their inheritance very hastily? I leave that to you. And a note on that one would be Proverbs 28:20. You thought I was going to give you a New Testament gospel, didn't you? I'll let you look that one up yourself. But, the end thereof shall not be blessed. Luke 15. You say, well, there was a big party in the end. That wasn't his inheritance. His inheritance was all spent when he was in the pig pen. That was the result of his inheritance. I don't know what he got when he got back home, because he took his inheritance. That just ends with a party. My son was dead, now he's alive. So I always wondered about that. He came back to the Father, but all his inheritance was gone. You know his brother wasn't going to give him anything. Unless you had the case, and I don't know, now this could be totally wrong, you throw in the garbage. Maybe the brother who wouldn't do nothing for the Lord, you take from him and give it to him that has 10 talents. I don't know, but we'll move on. That verse is saying right there, you know what? You just may waste inheritance. That's what it's saying. Say not thou, I will recompense evil. Payback. Do unto others as others do unto you in vengeance. Don't say that. Don't say it. Never mind not doing it. The Bible says, "Don't say it." Don't you go, I'm gonna get him back. Don't you say that. I'll get even with her. Don't say it. Leave it as a thought and confess it under the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and get rid of it. Don't let it come out of your mouth. But wait on the Lord, and He shall save thee. Give it to the hands of the Lord. Lord's a lot better. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord in Romans. Not your vengeance. And they may be treating you like that because how they want to treat Jesus. What Paul was doing. Divers weights, here we go again, are an abomination to the Lord. And a false balance told you what divers means. Verse 10. Lying balance is not good. Man's goings are of the Lord. Even a wicked man. Once Judas kept saying yes, 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 he was guided by the Lord. You know, at any point he could have said no, no, no. Pharaoh had opportunity after opportunity to repent and get right. But he didn't. So God used it. How can a man then understand his own way? How are you going to know? And don't even try to figure out what that person's doing when you can't even figure out your own walk. I don't know what the Lord has for me. But I know He's using me. How is He going to do it? The only way I can tell you is if I look back. And even then I may not understand it all the way. I can't look forward and say, oh yeah, the Lord's got this place for me, and there it's going to be, and this is how He's going to do it, and this is going to be the loophole, this is going to be the valleys, this is going to be, I can't do that. The Lord may turn around and say, yeah, I'll show you something. I'll give you something, all right. I'll give you a swift kick in the butt for thinking that you're Mr. Perfect. You know, you think you're a prophet. I'll show you how much you're a prophet. Let the Lord be the way. And the Lord will give you understanding to what He wants to give you understanding. You always don't have to know. Job never found out, as far as we're told, what happened to him. He never found out it was Satan behind the scenes. Unless he read his own book. We don't know. It is a snare to a man who devoureth that which is holy. Uh-oh. And afterwards vowed to make inquiry. Or, let me find my note. Oh yeah, like I'm going to be able to read that. Is you're doing something, and then later on you try to figure out how to get out of it. Kind of a trench prayer when you're in warfare. Oh Lord, if you get me out of this, I'll go home and be a preacher like Mama wanted me to be. And you get home, you're with Mama, and then you know what? I crossed my fingers, God, or you know, no one would have me. But to devour that which is holy. David had showbread that wasn't supposed to be his. But I don't think that's the case. How about someone that takes the bullock that was supposed to be offered and he uses it for hamburgers? Or the sheep that was supposed to be brought to the temple and he sells it for money? And then he comes back, well, Lord, you know, probably. A wise king scatters the wicked. You can't find that in America. Like I said, you can't find a king in America. But where in America have they scattered the wicked? You know, we still can have freedom as Bible-believing Christians under Jesus Christ and still tell other religions to get the hell out. How do you do that? You don't need a constitution. This nation is going to be under the King James Bible, under the authority of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, as servant of this country, no other religion. If you profess that Jesus Christ is not God, you are not allowed here. You must believe in the virgin birth, and the death, burial, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ to be in this country. There you go. You got settled. Bingo! Well, we're just a Christian nation on it. What are we going to do? We'll send missionaries out to those in the world who don't know God and don't want to worship Him. Like, we're kind of sending missionaries out now. England did it. The Bible, the man said that the sun never set on the English Empire with all the missionaries they sent out. Now look where they are. The king scares the wicked. Oh, I know there's no king over there, but look at what that queen is getting involved in the mess. Sodomites, rock and roll, adulteries, divorces, and nudity of her family. You know, there was a time when the Methodists in this country would shut bars down. People would stop sinning. Adultery wasn't on the TV. It was hidden in the darkness. Factory owners would invite them in, come and preach during the lunch hour. You know, there was times in America when a preacher would go off into some little field on the side of a road, sit and preach, and people would come and hear him. When was the last time I gave a regular message on the side of a street and just open up the Bible and say, okay, let's have a Bible study, and people gather around, sat down? No, they're wicked. For one person, I'll come up and say, hey, I'm glad for what you're doing. 250,000 will walk by. I have no regard to God. They won't even stop to find out what God wants from them. And bringeth the wheel over them. Ouch. The wheel was a wheel that you put over somebody who was wicked. It's a form of punishment. And I guarantee it taught you something. I'm trying to find my note here. Ezekiel 1:10. The spirit, 1 Corinthians 2:11, of man is the candle of the Lord. Light. That light that's put out because the one that curses his parents, verse 20. You curse your parents, and in that light that God has, your spirit, it's gone. Now, they may not give you capital punishment in the flesh. Your spirit is gone in the eyes of God. Aren't you glad we're under grace? You ever seen a child curse his father and mother? Today? You better thank God for grace. Because in the Old Testament, that child would, even if they did not stone him, that child, there was no offering, I would assume, for a child, because I don't see a child bring. It says if your child doesn't do right, you were to bring him to the priest, and they were to put a charge upon him, and then they would stone him. That means you would die and go to hell. But today in America, what happens is you don't raise your child right. He goes to school, or he goes to an open area or a mall or somewhere and shoots 20, 25 people, and they die and go to hell. And then you give him hotel correction for the rest of his life. And you can ban all the guns you want. You can take away every gun in the world and they'll pick up sticks and stones. I guess you have to register them too. The first weapon in the Bible was either a stick or a stone. I don't think there was gunshots for Cain to go walk in. Searching all the inward parts of the belly. I don't know why it says belly. Jeremiah 17:9. John 3:6-9, 2 Thessalonians 2:10-12. Mercy and truth preserve the king, and his throne is upheld by mercy. James 2:13. I know you're waiting for me to say something about America. I'm not going to mention America net worth, because there is no mercy and there's no truth. So I'm not even going to waste my tongue. The glory of a young man is their strength. Ooh, look at these muscles. Ooh, look at me. Muscles. I got a hair on my chest. Look, hey, I can lift weights. I can, you know, pump iron. Me, macho man. Yes, true. And the beauty of old man is the gray head. The gray head says, hey, you got wisdom. The muscles tell you got strength. Which is better in that verse? What's those muscles going to do for the of an old man? Ain't going to do you much. Gray hair, we have already read about, brings on wisdom usually. A man who's lived, a man who has had experience under his belt. I can throw a football 500 million times down the thing. Hey, rah, 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 rah. Here you line up, the ball starts. There you go. Oh, my arm. Medic. And they take you off the field, and you're no more quarterback. What are you going to do? Oh, yeah, you went to college, and you had people pay for you to do your tests and stuff like that. What are you going to do for a living? Oh, yeah, you had $2 million contracts, you had all that, but you blew it on wine, booze, and women. What are you going to do? No, you can have an old gray-head man. He goes to work, and, okay, he gets injured in a job, and he takes what money he has, and he takes it to someone and says, listen, how can I invest this? I'm going to be living 40, 50, 60 more years, and what little money I have, I need help on my old age. Now, verse 30 is one of these places that I have a question mark. The blueness of a wound, black and blue, cleanses away evil. So there's some kind of correction. So do stripes. Now, we know from the Lord Jesus Christ, Isaiah 53, that is from a cat of nine, Paul was whipped. Now, I don't understand this. Do stripes in the inward parts of the belly. And then we come back over here. It says in verse 27, the spirit of man is akin to the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly. Guess what I'm going to tell you? There are some things I don't know. I don't know how stripes... inward parts of the belly. Not they rip you open and there's your inward parts of the belly. Something about the stripes does something to your stomach. Blueness of a wound cleanses away evil. A black and blue gets rid of evil. It's not more being punched in the arm or given a black eye. And it's for your well-being. Now, I have government schools and home, Hebrews 12:6. Comes down to something with correction. And with the minus of correction that we don't have in America today, that's why evil is rampant. We've gone away from it. And we'll close there.